Welcome to Chemistry Lover, and in this video series we are learning organic chemistry from the very basics. So this is the part 8 of this series. And I will suggest you to watch the previous videos before watching this. So in this part we are going to discuss about hyperconjugation in detail, and also negative hyperconjugation, bridging carbocations and all other things. So what is hyperconjugation? So as the name suggests, it is a conjugation, but not usual conjugation, and sometimes it is also referred to as no bond resonance. So that means in the previous videos we have seen conjugation, that whenever you have two pi systems which are close to one another, the p orbitals of one pi system conjugate with p orbital of other pi system. Similarly, let's say you have some anion or cation and you have conjugated pi with it. So this is called conjugation, that all these pi orbital overlap with each other, and this is called the conjugation. This is the regular conjugation. But what is hyperconjugation? Hyperconjugation is when a sigma bond, not a pi bond, but a sigma bond do this conjugation with another sigma bond or another pi bond. So hyperconjugation means the conjugation of a sigma bond. It may be a CH sigma bond or it may be a CC sigma bond, but it is a sigma bond. So hyperconjugation means the conjugation between a sigma bond with another pi bond or another sigma bond. So what type of hyperconjugations are overall possible then? So there are many kind of hyperconjugation possible. For example, CC to CH hyperconjugation, CC to CC hyperconjugation, then CH to CH hyperconjugation, also CH to lone pair hyperconjugation, CH to anion hyperconjugation, and CH to cation hyperconjugation. So all these sort of hyperconjugations are possible, and we will see one by one stepwise, right? So let us first talk about very simple thing, that is the CH and CH hyperconjugation. So for that we will take this simple molecule, ethane. Let's say you have this ethane molecule which has the conformation, staggered conformation here, this one, okay? So this is the staggered conformation of ethane molecule. Now if you just look into these two hydrogens, so they are anti-periplanar to one another. So I will omit other hydrogen atoms and emphasize these two more. So if I draw their molecular orbitals, so you can see this is one sigma bond, this is the sigma CH, and this is another sigma CH, okay? Similarly, there will be, this is sigma star CH, and there will be another sigma star CH, okay? So now, because this CH sigma and this CH sigma, they are anti-periplanar to one another, also this sigma star CH and this sigma star CH, they are anti-periplanar to one another, they can overlap. So what will be the interaction diagram? So the interaction diagram will be very simple. Let's say this is one sigma star CH and this is another sigma star CH. So for the other side, here we will have one sigma star CH and here we will have another sigma CH, and this is our alpha level, okay? At the middle we have alpha level. Now because these are sigma bonds, so you know that sigma and sigma star are separated with very high amount of energy. So let's say this is energy axis. I don't know whether my drawing is justified or not, but you have to know that the energy gap between the sigma star and the sigma is very high, and that's why only overlap between these two sigma is possible, and similarly overlap between these two sigma star is possible, right? So this is psi 1, this is psi 2, and the psi 1 and psi 2 are only only contributed by this sigma and this sigma. Sorry, this is not sigma star, but this is sigma. Okay, this is not sigma star, this is actually sigma. So this psi 1 and psi 2 is contributed by only this sigma and this sigma, whereas the psi 3 and the psi 4 are contributed by this sigma star and this sigma star. Okay, now we have a total 4 electrons, so we can fill these 4 electrons here. Now, because this orbital has only contribution from this one and this one, so that's why if you now calculate this energy E1 and this energy E2, you will see that E2 is greater than E1, right? So that means the antibonding orbital, this is actually, we can say antibonding compared to this one. Overall, this is both of them are bonding, but if you just forget about this sigma star interaction, if you just consider this sigma interaction, then this is bonding and this is our antibonding, we can say. So actually the energy of this psi 2 is rising, whereas the energy of psi 1 is lowering. But as E2 is greater than E1, so energy is rising more than it goes below, right? So overall this is a destabilizing situation. Destabilizing situation. So CH sigma bond to CH sigma bond hyperconjugation is a destabilizing situation, we can see. Now this is not very much significant. This CH sigma bond hyperconjugation is not very much significant, and you can see in a molecule, in a large molecule, there are several of this CH bond, and if you consider the overall effect, it doesn't make any sense, right? But in some cases, if you consider the cyclohexane molecule, you can see, if you consider the cyclohexane molecule, you can see this axial hydrogen and the adjacent axial hydrogen, these two are actually parallel to one another, and there will be hyperconjugation between these two. Also, the equatorial hydrogen will have hyperconjugation with this CC bond. So this CC bond, CC sigma and this CH sigma, there will also be a hyperconjugation. And this effect of this hyperconjugation is seen in the coupling constant of the CH coupling constant value. So this is called Parlin effect, which I will discuss in detail when I will discuss NMR spectroscopy. Okay, but you should know that this hyperconjugation has an effect on the coupling constant. Now let us move on to the next topic, that is the hyperconjugation between a CCH bond and a cation or an anion. So for that we have to consider this system. Which system? So let's say this is a CH bond and you have a carbon p orbital over here. Now when this p orbital is filled, it is anion. When it is empty, it is cation. So what will be the interaction diagram? So interaction diagram will be, first we have to draw the sigma. So this is, sorry, this is the sigma star of the CH bond, sigma star of CH, and this is the sigma of CH, and this is our alpha level, and our carbon p orbital will be somewhere here. Okay, so this is our carbon p orbital. Now when the interaction takes place between these three orbitals, we will have three molecular orbitals. So one molecular orbital will be here, another molecular will be here, and other molecular orbital will be here. So all these molecular orbitals we will get out of this interaction, right? So these are the molecular orbitals. Now consider this as an anion. If it is an anion, what will happen? So if it is an anion, then we will have four electrons, right? So we can fill the four. So this is psi 1, this is psi 2, and this is psi 3. So we can fill the four electrons here and here. Now you can see the psi 2 level is actually above the alpha level, right? So that means it is an mostly an antibonding situation. So overall the situation is antibonding, and overall this is a destabilizing situation. So this is a destabilizing situation. So when we have anion adjacent to CH bond, so this is, in this diagram we are considering anion, right? So when we have anion which is adjacent to a CH bond, this hyperconjugation will be a destabilizing situation. Why? Because you can see overall the energy is rising because we are filling 4 electrons over here. Now this energy lowering is very low because this p orbital will have very little interaction with this sigma CH bond. But if you consider cation, then what will happen? Then we will have only 2 electrons. So if you now consider cation, we will have only 2 electrons. So this orbital is now empty. This is now empty. Okay. And only this orbital is filled. And you can see overall there is an energy drop of amount E. But this E amount is very little. And if you consider this particular drawing, this energy diagram, it is similar like that of allyl cation. If you remember the allyl cation, it has similar structure. But what is the difference is, in case of allyl cation, this drop of energy is much higher compared to this one. Because in case of allyl cation, what we considered? We consider the interaction between CC pi bond, CC pi star bond and the carbon p orbital over here. So this carbon p orbital over here and this CC pi bond, they are very close to energy. You can see they are very close to energy. So that's why there is a strong overlap. This strong overlap will give very high energy lowering. But in this case, you can see this is sigma CH bond, which has very low energy compared to the carbon p orbital. And that's why the overlap here is not that strong. And this amount of energy which is lowered is not that strong. So that's why allyl cation case is more stable compared to this hyperconjugation. But nonetheless, hyperconjugation is a stabilization situation for cation. So what we can see is hyperconjugation can make a cation stable, right? Now this is the diagram for CH hyperconjugation, but you can draw the similar diagram for a CC bond. And the effect of CC bond is very interesting when we consider a cyclopropyl substituent. For example, let's say we have this thing, we have this cation, where we have a cation adjacent to a cyclopropane ring. And here these sigma bonds, these CC sigma bonds, they participate in this CC sigma 2 cation hyperconjugation, right? So there is a hyperconjugation between this CC sigma bond and this p orbital. And the evidence is, let's say you have this example. So let's say you have this chloride and you react it with ethanol. So this is a solvolysis reaction, and out of this reaction you will get this. Similarly, you can do a same kind of reaction with this substrate, which is a allylic chloride, and if you do the reaction with ethanol, you will get this product. Now this reaction, the above reaction, is 41 times faster compared to this below reaction. So this is because the reaction is going through the carbocation. In the first case, you are getting this carbocation. In the second case, you are getting this carbocation. And this carbocation is actually stabilized by what? By resonance, like this. So you have a resonance stabilization. And we know that resonance stabilization is a very good stabilization phenomenon. But here we can see that this is a more stable carbocation compared to this one, and this is because of this hyperconjugation. Now what are the orbitals involved here? So let me draw it. So let's say this is the case, this is the empty p orbital. Now we will draw another p orbital over here, and this is our cyclopropane ring, right? So this is the other orbitals which are composed of this cyclopropane ring. So you can see, so in the fifth part of this series, I have explained the pictorial diagram of cyclopropane. So what is the pictorial diagram? This is the pictorial diagram of a cyclopropane, right? So same thing I have drawn here. Now in this case, you can see this filled orbital will have conjugation with this empty orbital. This is empty orbital. So this filled orbital will have conjugation with this empty orbital, and this is a kind of CC2 cation hyperconjugation. hyperconjugation, right? So you can see hyperconjugation may be a very strong stabilization thing, right? So which is evidenced from this particular thing. And whatever stability we consider for a cation like this one, alkyl substituted cation, let's say all the groups are methyl group, so we say inductive effect is the stabilization effect, but it is hyperconjugation which is more important than inductive effect, because inductive effect is only a sigma bond phenomenon, but hyperconjugation is the real thing which works through the pi bond, right? So this is your sigma CH bond, and this is how this hyperconjugation is possible. And here you can see 3, 3 and 3, so 9 hyperconjugating hydrogens are there. So it is a very stable carbocation. This carbocation is a very stable carbocation. Now here is a misconception that, so if we consider the stability of all these cations like this one, let's say this this carbocation, then this carbocation, then this carbocation, and let's say this tart butyl group over here, all these groups are tart butyl group. So when we have all the methyl groups, this is the most stable carbocation. When we replace one hydrogen by some alkyl group, the stability slightly reduced. When we replace two hydrogen groups, the stability even reduced, and this is the least stabilized. So this is 1, this is 2, this is 3, this is 4. So we say that 1 is most stable, then 2, then 3, and then 4. Actually 2 and 3 are almost same, but the case is 1 is most stable and 4 is least stable. So people say that in this case methyl is most electron donating, whereas tart butyl group is the least electron donating. And based on this fact, many people conclude that it is the CH bond which is a better donor through hyperconjugation, because here we have the CH bonds, but it is in this case we have this CC bond, and CC bonds are weaker electron donor through hyperconjugation. But this is not actually the case. This stabilization order is not because of the hyperconjugation at all, and this is a misconception that hyperconjugation is the thing why methyl is better donor and tart butyl is a poor donor. It is not like that. It is because of the solvation of the cation. So when you have three tart butyl group, this cation is, solvation of this cation is very small, whereas when you have all the methyl group, this cation is very highly solvated. So whatever this data we are considering, the stability data, thermodynamic stability data, we are dealing with a solvent phenomenon when the cation is in the solvent, and solvation effect is a very important effect. Hyperconjugation cannot only determine the stability, we have to consider the solvent effect. And when we consider solvent effect, it is the solvent effect for which this methyl group is better electron donor compared to tart butyl group, and which is a better donor, whether CC bond or CH bond, it is a point of debate and inconclusive. So you cannot say that methyl group is better donor because of its hyperconjugating ability. Not, it is not like that. It is because of the solvation, right? So this is very important, you should remember it. Now let us talk about some more interesting things. So if you have a CH bond, so we have seen that if you have a CH bond, the hyperconjugation is a stabilization situation when you have a cation adjacent to it. So for a cation, it is a stabilizing situation, stability. But for anion and for lone pair, it is a destabilization situation. In fact, if you consider the Greek nut reagent, for example, this one, let's say you have this negative charge over here and this is one hydrogen. So in fact these hydrogens are very much hydrogen sometimes act as hydride donor, right? So Greek nut reagent sometimes acts as hydride donor. Why? Because if you consider this hydrogen and this lone pair or this negative charge, that is the two electron, so what will happen is this overlap will take place. So this is the sigma star. So this overlap will take place and this hydride go as a leaving group. So because of this destabilization through hyperconjugation, when you have a carb anion adjacent to a CH bond, that CH bond act as a hydride donor. So this is because of the destabilization. Another thing is, if you consider this example, so here let's say you have two oxygen atoms, two hetero atoms, and now if you consider the hyperconjugation of these two hydrogens, so let me use different color. So this axial hydrogen, so it will have hyperconjugation with this axial hydrogen, whereas this equatorial hydrogen will have hyperconjugation with this CC bond, right, with this CC bond and also with this CC bond. Now you will see that hyperconjugation between this CH and this CC bond is much stronger compared to that between this CH bond and this CH bond, because we know that CH-CH hyperconjugation is a destabilization phenomenon. But if you consider the hyperconjugation between this CH bond and this CO bond, what will happen? So this is your CO bond and this is your CH bond, right? So here what you have to consider, you have to again consider the, so this is the sigma CO and this is the sigma star CO, and here you will have sigma CH and here you will have sigma star CH. So there you will have interaction between these two and between these two. But now see, this sigma star is now close to this sigma, and that's why this so it is psi 1, it is psi 2, it is psi 3, it is psi 4, and now this psi 2 is also contributed with this sigma star, and this is a bonding situation. So that's why if you now consider this as E1 and this as E2, so now E1 may be greater than E2 because of this contribution. So because this sigma star is lower in energy, it is contributing, bonding contribution to this psi 2 makes this E1 greater than E2. So this is now lowering in energy, right? So that means overall this is a stabilizing situation. If you fill these two electrons, it is now overall a stabilizing situation. It is lower than the alpha level and it is a stabilizing situation because E1 is now greater than E2, and this is possible because this presence of this hetero atom, presence of this hetero atom oxygen makes both this sigma and this sigma star orbital lower in energy, and that's why this contribution is now possible. In the previous case, when we had only sigma and sigma star CH bond, we couldn't have this contribution because they are very far apart in their energy, right? So this is very important, and that's why this hyperconjugation between this CC bond and this CH bond is stronger compared to the other one, that is this CH and this CH bond. So if you look into the bond length, you will see that this bond will be lengthened, right? So this CC bond, you will have more bond length compared to normal case because of this hyperconjugating effect. Now let us talk about the bridging carbocation. Before that, another interesting example I want to show is that, so let's say this is a but this is a cage type structure, and you have this. So let's say here you have the carbocation. Now if you consider the p orbital over here, so here you will have empty p orbital, right? So this p orbital will have hyperconjugation with this CH bond, with this CH bond, and with this CC bond, right? So all this CH and this CC bond will have hyperconjugation with this p orbital, and that's why you will see that all these bonds, this bond, and this bond will be short. This bond will be short than usual sp3 bonds, but it will be this one, yeah. So this one, because hyperconjugation is between between this one and this p orbital, this CH bond and this p orbital, and also this CH bond and this p orbital. So these are the hyperconjugating thing, and this orbit, this bond actually, it will be lengthened. So it will be long. Why? Because it is participating in the hyperconjugation. Because it is participating in the hyperconjugation, this bond will be bond lengthening will be there, right? So this is a very interesting example of hyperconjugation thing with a carbocation. So what we conclude is that hyperconjugation is a pretty good effect in a stabilization of a carbocation. Now let us talk about bridging carbocation. So whatever we have seen in hyperconjugation is that, let's say you have this empty p orbital over here and you have this CH sigma bond. So the sigma bond participate in hyperconjugation with this empty p orbital. Now and a case may occur where this hydrogen will be in between these. So now we can also consider this as 2p orbital. So we can use this hybridization concept, that is, in this case we denote this as sp3 hybrid, but we can also explain the same thing by considering this as pure p orbital as here. So this is the pure p orbital and let's say this hydrogen is here. So now a case may occur that this hydrogen is in between these two p orbital, that is, it is interacting both with this p orbital and with this p orbital. So this is a case of bridging situation. You can see this is a case of bridging situation. It is a like a 2-electron-3-center bond, right? In case of diboron, we have seen this type of bonding, 3-electron-3-center bond, but in this case it is a 2-electron-3-center bond, and this is a bridging situation. Now what is the practical example of the bridging situation? So again, let's say we take this carbocation with this cyclopropane substituent. Now this bond can shift over here and the transition state will be like this. So yeah, so you can see in the transition state, this is this particular carbon is interacting both with this center and this center, and overall here you will have a positive charge, right? So another after this shift, what you will get? You will get this thing, positive charge over here. Now again this bond can shift over here and you will get this one. So in this case, this is the bridging carbocation. And what is the evidence? So this is a thing we are saying solely because of our theoretical knowledge that we can have this bridging situation, but this is a practical example. And what is the evidence that this bridging carbocation exists? So the evidence is, if you treat this compound with any nucleophile, Nu minus, you will have all these products. This is Nu. Here, from here you will have this Nu. From here you will have this Nu. And also interestingly, you will have this thing. So from here what you will get? So in this case the carbocation, product which you will get is, you can see, so this is shifting over here. So this is shifting over here. Now what will happen? The nucleophile will attack over this center. Okay, so the nucleophile will attack over here and you will have double bond over here. And so this is 1 2 3 4, so this, and here you will have this nucleophile. So what is happening? The nucleophile is attacking over here. So this product we get, and this product we can only get when this bridging carbocation is there. If the bridging carbocation wouldn't exist, then we would not get this product. We would get only this product and all these three products. But as we are getting this product, is proving that indeed the bridging carbocation is existing. And I made a detailed video on bridging carbocation. The Wagner Merwin shift. The video, the link of the video I will give in the description. Please go through it. It is a very important video, and that's why I'm not discussing the bridging carbocation in detail here. Okay. Now, so this is the thing, the bridging carbocation and all these things. Now let us talk about what is the effect of hyperconjugation on a pi bond. So the effect of hyperconjugation on pi bond. Okay, what is the effect of hyperconjugation on a pi bond? Now, if you consider this compound, let's say you have this compound, and if you treat this with acid, it will take this acid to form first this carbocation, and after that, from this carbocation, you will get this alkene. Okay, so elimination of proton will take place from here. You will get this. So you will not get this alkene again, rather you will get this alkene as your major product. So that means it is implying that this alkene is thermodynamically more stable compared to this one. Now what is the reason behind this thermodynamic stability? So this thermodynamic stability of this more, so this is, you can see, more substituted alkene. It is substituted with three alkene alkyl group, whereas this one is substituted with only two alkyl groups. So we can see that more substituted alkenes are more stable, and this we know from our childhood. But what is the reason why more substituted alkenes are more stable? So the reason again is the hyperconjugation. Now in this case, the hyperconjugation is between the CH sigma and CC pi. So what we have to draw is, we have to draw the CC pi bond first. So let's say this is our CC pi and this is our CC pi star. Okay, and so our where our sigma bond will be, so our CH sigma bond will be somewhere here. Okay, our CH sigma will be somewhere here, and another is the CH sigma star, right? So this is the CH sigma star. So again, you can see the CH sigma will interact with this CC pi and this. Okay, so these two will interact, and also this CH sigma star will interact with this CC pi star. So these two will interact like this. So we have this psi 1, this psi 2, this psi 3, and this psi 4, right? Now, because this CC pi star is lower in energy compared to CH sigma star, it will contribute to this psi 2, and this is a bonding contribution. So now if we calculate this E1 and this E2, so what you will get is this E1 is greater than E2. So overall it is a stabilizing situation, a bonding situation. We have here two electrons from this pi orbitals and two electrons from this CH sigma. So these two orbitals are filled with four electrons, but energy of this two electron rises, energy of this two electron is lower down, but the lower down of energy E1 is higher compared to the rise of energy E2. We can see here, and this is because of this contribution from this CC pi star, which is not possible when we consider only CH sigma star, which we have seen at the very beginning of the video. So again, here the overall situation is stabilization. So from this molecular orbital diagram, we can see because of this contribution from this CC pi star orbital, the overall situation is a stabilization situation, and that's why more substituted alkene is always more stable compared to a less substituted alkene. So we can now say why a more substituted alkene is more stable. Now the next thing which I will discuss is the CM hyperconjugation, and in this case M refers to any metal, but for organic chemists, metal means anything which is more electropositive than carbon, and we basically deal with silicon and other groups like silicon based groups, and boron, all these things we consider as metal. So we are basically talking about this fragment. That is, let's say you have let's say you have this situation, you have this SiMe3 group and you have adjacent cation, or you can have adjacent anion. So what will be the effect of this cation or anion on this hyperconjugation of this cation or this anion on this what will be the effect of this SiMe3? So basically SiC sigma, what will be the effect of this SiC sigma bond on this cation or on this anion? So again we have to draw the molecular orbital, but before that we have to look into the sigma difference in sigma bond between a CC sigma bond and a heteroatom sigma bond, when the heteroatom is electronegative and a heteroatom when it is electropositive. So let's say this is your p orbital of carbon, okay, and we are considering the sigma bond. So we will not use this p orbital, rather we will use the pz orbital like this. So this is pc, and if you consider oxygen it will have lower energy, so here you will have po, whereas if you consider now silicon it will have higher energy because it is more electropositive. So here you will have silicon, so this is psi. So now if you construct the molecular orbitals, what you will get, you will get this one, this one, this is the sigma star, this is the sigma star for which bond, for the CO bond, and the sigma star orbital for the CSI bond will be here. So this is sigma CSI and this is the sigma star CSI. So what we can see here is that the sigma C, so this is filled with electrons. So what we want to see is that the sigma CSI has higher energy than sigma CO, right? Now if you consider the interaction of let's say p orbital, right? So let's say you have this p orbital over here, it may be cation or anion. When it is filled it is anion, when it is empty it is cation. So this is carbon p orbital PO, and if you now consider the sigma CSI bond, so the sigma CSI bond will be somewhere here, right? Somewhere here, and the sigma star CSI will be somewhere here. So this is sigma star CSI, this is sigma CSI, and now you can see this sigma and this P, they can interact very strongly, right? So you will have three molecular orbitals like this. So this interaction is very strong and this energy drop is very high. And let's say if it is a cation, it is a case of cation, so you have to place two electrons over here, so energy of this two electron is raised very high. So in case of CH bond, because this CH bond, the sigma bond energy of the CH bond is very low, and it is very far apart from this p orbital, so the interaction was low and this energy lowering was small, so that E was very small. But in this case, because it is very close to this p orbital, these two are very close to one another, and that's why this is a strong overlap. This is a case of strong overlap. And also you can see this carbon here is more electronegative than silicon, so the filled orbital, the bonding orbital, the coefficient of this bonding orbital will have more contributed by carbon orbital. So the coefficient of this orbital will be more on carbon, so that's why in both cases the overlap is very strong and energy lowering is very high. So that means whenever you have this type of situation, that is a cation which is adjacent to SiMe3 group or any other metal, this is a very stabilizing situation, and this metals, these cations are stabilized by these metals in a very strong way. So what will be their conformation? Their conformation will be like this. So this is your SiMe3 group, and if you draw the orbital, it will be like this. SiMe3 group. So they will be collinear to one another, they will be parallel to one another. Another conformation is possible, which is like this. That is when they are perpendicular to one another, and you can see it will not be favorable. Why it is not favorable? Because in this case there is no overlap between these two. So that's why this conformation is favorable over this. So whenever you form any so let's say you have a situation where you have this SiMe3 group and you have a leaving group over here, and during the reaction you are forming a carbocation like this. Let's say you are forming a carbocation like this. So it will retain its conformation throughout the reaction because of this hyperconjugative interaction, right? So this hyperconjugative interaction, it will retain its conformation throughout the reaction, and accordingly you will get the product. Okay. Now the next thing which I will discuss is the effect of this CM hyperconjugation on anion. What will be the effect of this CM hyperconjugation on anion? So again, you can see, you can use the same diagram. This is the same diagram which you can use for this case of anion, and in this case the alpha level will be here. So this orbital is actually above the alpha level, and now if you consider anion in place of cation, so this orbital will now be filled with electrons, right? And the energy is raised now, so that's why it is overall a destabilization situation. So when you consider this case SiMe3 and you have filled electrons, so this is a destabilization, and it will prefer to stay in the conformation like this one. That is when there will be no overlap between these two. Okay, this is the case of destabilization. Now let us see the next thing, that is the negative hyperconjugation. What is the negative hyperconjugation? So till now we discussed the positive hyperconjugation or the normal hyperconjugation, where electron donation takes place from either a CH bond or a CC bond or a CM bond. So in all this case, electron donation takes place from these bonds. In case of negative hyperconjugation, we have a CX bond where X is electronegative. It may be fluorine, it may be chlorine, or it may be oxygen like that. And in this case, instead of electron donation, it is electron acceptor. So this bond, this sigma bond, is electron acceptor. Okay, this sigma bond is electron acceptor. Let us look at a very simple example. Let's say you have some anion over here, and adjacent to this you have a CX bond. This X may be fluorine. Okay, so we have to draw the molecular orbital of this. So let's say this is our p orbital PC, this p orbital. Okay, and now we have to draw the sigma star of this CX bond and the sigma of this CX bond. Okay, so because X is heteroatom, so this sigma will have lower energy, so it will have energy somewhere here, sigma of CX, and the sigma star will have energy somewhere here, the sigma star CX. Now again we will have three molecular orbitals like this, three molecular orbitals like this. This is psi 1, this is psi 2, this is psi 3, and we are considering the case of anion. So these two will now be filled, And in this case, this psi 2 will be below the alpha level. Why it is below the alpha level? Because in this case, this sigma is a Cx sigma, where x is electronegative element. Because it is electronegative element, so its energy, overall its energy is lower, and that's why this orbital's energy will be lower compared to this non-bonding level. So it is lower in energy compared to this non-bonding level, right? So it is lower compared to this non-bonding level, and it is also contributed by this sigma star, right? It is also contributed by this sigma star. So overall it is a bonding situation. Overall it is a bonding situation, and in this case this overlap is more between this PC and this CX, right? So what is interesting here is that this energy lowering is not that much high, because this CX is much lower than PC. So actual drawing should be like this. So this is our PC, let's say this is our PC. So this sigma will be very low, this sigma will be somewhere here, sigma X, and the sigma star is actually, the sigma star CX is actually close to this P. So that means strong overlap will occur between this P and the sigma star, and it will be somewhere here, okay? So it will be somewhere here, another orbital will be somewhere here, and this orbital will be here, this psi, yeah. So this is our psi 1, this is our psi 2, and this is our psi 3. So this is the actual drawing, and you can see this psi 2 is actually below the P, and why? Because it is strongly contributed by this sigma star orbital. This is a bonding situation, and this makes this lower in energy. Now these two are filled, so overall this is a bonding situation. In this CX bond, you will see this X is heteroatom, which is electronegative. That means this sigma star has more coefficient over this carbon, right? The sigma star has more coefficient over this carbon. So both this sigma star is close in energy to this carbon p orbital. Also the sigma star has more contribution or more coefficient on the carbon atom. So both situation favors the overlap between this PC and this sigma star, and that's why this energy is lower. So if this is your alpha level, this E2, and this is, let's say, E1, so this energy lowering here, E2, is more contributing factor here compared to E1, because this is not a big deal. As this PC and this sigma is is far apart from one another, so the energy lowering of this psi 2 is main contributing factor why the negative charge adjacent to a electronegative group is stable, and this is the case of negative hyperconjugation. Now in real situation, we don't have this kind of group where we have a negative charge and adjacent fluorine like this, but this negative hyperconjugation is seen in many systems, and one special mention is the anomeric effect. What is anomeric effect? So in glucose system, let's say we have this glucose molecule where we have this let's say in case of glucose molecule, for the anomeric position, this is called the anomeric position, this one, and it can have two conformation. Either let's say you have this OME group over here, so this OME may be axial, so all other groups are like this OH, this OH, OH, and here also OH. So this OME may be this axial, or this OME may be equatorial. OME may be equatorial, and these are all this, sorry, this is OH, this is OH, this is OH, this is OH, and also here you have oxygen. Now between these two, this is called alpha, this is called beta. When OME is above, it is beta. When OME is below, it is alpha. Now between this alpha and beta, it is seen that this beta is more stable, and it is not only for glucose, it is in general when you have a cyclohexane type system where you have a heteroatom like oxygen included in the ring, then if you have a electronegative substituent adjacent to it, it always prefer to stay in the axial position compared to equatorial position. Now what is the reason? The reason is the negative hyperconjugation. The hyperconjugation between this sigma star orbital, so this is the sigma star orbital of the CX bond, and you have this lone pair over here, right? So you have this lone pair over here. So this n sigma star interaction, we say, so this n sigma star interaction is the reason why this conformation is more stable. In the other conformation, when this is equatorial, you can see this is not possible because now the orbital orientation is not proper. So this orientation is not suitable for this n sigma star interaction. So this n sigma star interaction is the real example of this negative hyperconjugation, which we discussed considering a bare negative charge. This is the reason why this conformation is stable over the other one. Now what will be the effect when we have a cation adjacent to it? So let's say we have a cation adjacent to a CX bond. What will be the case? So in this case we have all these three, psi 3, psi 2, and the psi 1, and only psi 1 is filled. So if you consider only conjugation, overall it is a stabilizing situation, not very high, because in this case you can see only this level is filled, and I already told that this E1 energy, this amount of energy, is very low because the overlap between this sigma and this P is very weak. Why? Because they are far apart in energy from one another. But in case of cation, this orbital is empty and it has no contribution towards the stability. So we have to only consider about this E1 energy. So this is a stabilizing situation, but at the same time you can see this is a positive charge, and because it is a electronegative substituent, so it will have an inductive effect, so it will induce delta plus charge over. So there is a Coulombic repulsion, Coulombic repulsion. So this Coulombic repulsion makes overall the situation a destabilizing situation. So although this negative hyperconjugation gives somewhat stability, but because of the Coulombic repulsion, the situation is overall a destabilizing situation. So in this case, let's say you have two kind of conformation possible, right? So in this case, two kind of conformation possible. Either this, when this p orbital, so this is empty p orbital, it is parallel to this x bond, or it may be 90 degree with respect to this x bond. And in this case, this is preferred over this one, because when it is 90 degree to x, it is now parallel to other bonds, like you can have hydrogen over here, so then it can have a positive hyperconjugation to this cation, which will stabilize the system. The worst situation is when you have this kind of CF3 group, all are fluorine, then you cannot manage by rotating the bond, and in every possible way you have this negative hyperconjugation and also this inductive effect and Coulombic repulsion. So this is the worst carbocation which you can have. So overall we can see negative hyperconjugation can stabilize a negative center, and in the previous video I discussed about this particular example. So I don't know whether you remember it or not. So let's say you have a negative charge in this bridging position, and it was stabilized into this sigma star orbital. This is the sigma star orbital, this is n. So this stabilization, so this is also considered as negative hyperconjugation, which I discussed in the previous video. So this is the thing. I will end this video here. In the next video I will discuss about some more interesting thing. So stay tuned. Have a good day.